Look at verse number 12. We'll read verse 12 through verse 15. How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? How art thou cut down to the ground, which didst weaken the nations? For thou hast said in thine heart, and here they start, and there's five of them. This is what Lucifer said. Number one, I will ascend into heaven. Number two, I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. Three, I will sit also upon the mount of the congregation in the sides of the north. Four, I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. And five, I will be like the Most High. Yet thou shalt be brought down to hell, to the sides of the pit. I want to preach on this subject of Lucifer and his determination to overthrow God. Through the Bible, we find many characters that are so influenced by Satan that the work would appear to be Satan's work. The king of Babylon may be the subject here, but this goes far beyond the king of Babylon, because he never was in heaven to fall from heaven. The being that we know today as Satan was originally an angel. Not only an angel, but in fact, the highest ranking angel that ever was. Stop and soak that in for a moment. The highest ranking angel. He was familiar with the operations of God. Everything that was going on in the glory land, he was in charge of it. And his desire to be like God, to overthrow God. Here is something before I pray that our minds cannot grasp, that God is infinite.
Amen.
We can say the word, but yet our minds cannot grasp hold of infinity.
Yeah.
Satan is finite. What I'm saying is God is limitless.
Uh-huh.
But Satan has limits.
Right.
God is immeasurable.
Right.
But Lucifer is measurable.
Right.
God is eternal. But Lucifer was created. So, with his desire to replace the eternal God, he's lost before he starts. How could he attain to infinity? How could he attain to being eternal? He started out not eternal. And so there's been enough eternity past that he could never do what he's intended to do. Am I making sense there?
Amen.
But as we go through the ages, this character has come so close to success that he keeps on trying to fight. He thought, if I can get rid of Adam and Eve, make them to sin, then I'll be replacing God's plan. But instead of replacing God's plan, God came up with another plan. He said, boy, if I can just get rid of Abel. But he didn't have any idea that God could give him another child. He's always missing. He thought he had them when he had Moses in that little basket fed to the crocodiles in the Nile. But it just so happened that God worked it to where that Pharaoh's daughter came down to bathe that evening, and she saved that hope. There was a wicked queen named Athaliah. Yeah. If you read the story of Athaliah, she tried to destroy the entire seed royal. And she was successful down to one little 7-year-old boy.
Yeah.
So Lucifer is always so close to obtain it. It looks like that he's going to win, and then he always loses. Have you ever been to one of those carnivals and you say, man, if I just give him another dollar, next time I'll be successful? That's the way Lucifer thinks. And I want to preach about that for a little while. And I know it may be an oversimplification, but a finite being is dependent, right?
Yeah.
Because he can't be independent or he'd be infinite.
That's right.
And so Satan is dependent. Believe it or not, he's dependent on God.
Right.
Let me pray and we'll get into this further. Our Heavenly Father, Lord, we admit to being finite ourselves. We admit that we're dependent on you. Lord, we need your help. We seek your aid. We pray, our Father, that you would help us as we preach. We pray, Lord, that you would cause somebody to realize that the God they're serving, if they're serving Satan, they're on the losing end. And I know, Father, that the world today, it looks like he's winning. It looks like things are going to come to pass in America just exactly the way Satan's plan would have it. But Lord, we also know that you're King of Kings and Lord of Lords. You set up one, you take down another. Father, help us to be dependent on you. I pray in Jesus' name, amen. So if I was to talk about the attributes of this Lucifer character as an angel of light, in Hebrews chapter 1 and verse 7, the Bible said that God made his angels as a spirit beings, that his ministers were a flame of fire. So then angels' substance is made out of fire. Now, fire is something you can't get hold of, but it can get hold of you.
Yeah, right.
Are you understanding what I'm saying?
Amen.
But are you aware that angels need to eat? The reason they need to eat is because they are finite beings. They are dependent upon God. Psalm chapter 78, verse 25. The Bible said that the Lord fed the children of Israel with angels' food. Amen?
Amen.
So angels eat. They have to. Wouldn't it be neat to eat food that comes from heaven? Prepared, cooked and served by God himself.
Yeah.
Talk about a fancy restaurant.
Yeah.
Ever how this thing works out? This fire that is a finite fire is a fire that will go out. But God is a fire that keeps burning and doesn't go out. Do you remember when Moses turned aside at the burning bush?
The Bible said he looked and there was a bush and it was burning just like any ordinary bush on fire, but the difference was that it wasn't consumed. Some scholars interpret Hebrews chapter 1 verse 7 as angel substance of being just pure energy. That they're made out of nothing but energy. But anybody that knows anything about energy knows that energy can run out. Amen? If we're like a battery, we need to be recharged, renewed by a source that is greater than we are.
Yes, amen.
So as the angels of God are there in the glory land, they are feeding off of a fire that's an eternal fire. Deuteronomy chapter 4 verse 24, God is a consuming fire. But unless controlled by His own will, our God who made the angels a fire is a fire that would overload their circuits. Anybody that's dealt with electricity knows what I'm talking about. If you've got a power source that is infinite and you plug some kind of a finite, unless you've got some way of stepping that power down, unless you've got some way of toning that fire down, the fire that's causing the energy will actually consume the fire that's going on. Ezekiel chapter 28 is another description of this Lucifer character. Haven't got him to being Satan yet. But in Ezekiel 28 and verse 16, it says of him that he walked up and down among the stones of fire. Wonder if he was getting recharged. Wonder if his fire would burn low and he could get into the throne room of God, had access, and he could get him some more fire by going in there. Some say that he drew his fire from being exposed to this other fire. Two fires. One is permanent. One is a fire that's self-sustaining, that'll never go out. The other is a fire that will go out unless it can find a source to renew it. Now we're talking about the angels. We're not talking about Satan yet. But as he was made as an angel, and angels eat, and that means then that they are dependent upon God to feed them some way, ever how you interpret that. The bottom line is that he is dependent upon God for his very existence. And yet has the nerve, if you will, to think that he can overcome that which feeds him. You're talking about the dog biting the hand that feeds it. The goal of Lucifer here in Isaiah chapter 14 and verse 14 is that I will be like the Most High. You cannot be like the Most High, because the Most High is an eternal fire. Yet, do you see what I'm saying? And any way that you look at it, there was a time when Satan was created. There was a time when he was not. And so if he's wanting to be eternal, he's an eternity too late. There's an eternity already gone that he wasn't in. Your goal is unattainable because you're a creature. Ezekiel 28:15, because there was a day when you were created. There was a day when you began. In everything that we see, that's why I say God is so beyond our comprehension, past our finding out. In everything that you see, it has a beginning. If you look around and see your friend sitting next to you, they're there because of their mommy and their daddy. And that goes on back and goes on back. It's got to be a point when that started. We submit to you that that point is when God made man of the dust of the ground, breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul. As we look at the sun, they tell us the sun is a fire that is burning, and as big as it is, and the multitudes of earth that it could contain, and yet it is a fire that is shrinking because it's burning and going out. Now, let's just add that back to these billions of years that the evolutionists tell the world is. If it is shrinking, 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 then you go back a billion years and it's growing, 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 growing. Is that right? And so we've got enough sun to fill the universe. There's only one explanation. And that explanation is there had to be a point in time back there somewhere when God ignited that fire of the sun.
Amen.
I submit Genesis chapter 1 that God made the sun and God made the moon. And because it is a made thing, it is finite. God is outside of everything that we know. As far as we can look, we can see finite space. God is outside of that. I'm saying God is bigger than you have any idea. Lucifer's scheme is doomed before it starts on that information alone. But then the kings of history have the same attitude as Lucifer himself. That's why Jesus called the Pharisees, "Ye are of your father the devil, the lust of your father you will do." Pharaoh said, "Who is the Lord that I should serve him? I'm God around here." Nebuchadnezzar said, "Look at all this stuff I've done. I'm God around here." Everywhere you look, there is a remarkable parallel between the scheme of Satan and the scheme of America's modern educational system. We're going to replace God. We don't need God. We can be a God ourselves. How remarkable that is. And yet I think that they come so close to accomplishing the goal, but they're doomed from the start to fail. They came up one day with the idea that we're going to build us a tower. And that tower is going to reach to heaven. And we won't need God anymore. We'll make our own way to heaven. But you see, about the time that they got their tower well under construction, the Lord came down, confounded their languages, and they left off to build the tower. How am I going to accomplish replacing God? You realize what this guy's goals are? How can he accomplish replacing God? Well, the chronology may be out of order, but let me say, the first thing that he wants to do is he's got to ascend into heaven. And he observed no authority that would stop him. He hadn't saw that God would stop him. If God is God, then he hasn't made any provision to stop me. Isn't that what people say today? If God is God, why don't he stop this? As they look at it, they see no reason to believe that they can't accomplish what they accomplished or what they set out to accomplish, because it appears to them that God is either uninterested or God is weak and cannot perform what he said. That's what it appeared to Satan or Lucifer as. But I think we need to take I think I may have said this last week. We need to take a look and see if our information is correct. We may have missed this thing. I would submit that you look in your Bible. Isaiah chapter 42 and verse 8. The Bible said, "I am the Lord, that is my name. My glory will I not give to another." Whenever you think you're going to take the glory that belongs to God, he's gave you a warning. It may not look like I'm going to do anything, but I guarantee you the day will come I will not give my glory to anybody else.
Amen.
I'll not give my glory Amen. I'll not give my glory to Lucifer. I'll not give my glory to any. My glory will stay my glory. I don't know how the Jehovah's Witnesses can come up with two gods. Because God don't share His glory. Let me say that the history book would be a good place to look. Look at the Tower of Babel, or Nimrod tried to annul the God of heaven. Look at Pharaoh that tried to annul the God of heaven, or Nebuchadnezzar, or Belshazzar, or Herod, or Caesar, or Mussolini, or Hitler, or anybody else that you want to look at. Whenever they say, I'm going to replace God, look what happens to them. Men unaware of history are doomed to repeat the same mistake. We need to study history so we'll know. Number two, he said, not only am I going to ascend into heaven, he said, I'm going to exalt my throne above the stars of God. Is that what that said? There is not an angel that Lucifer wasn't more powerful than. Michael, in contention with him, said, the Lord rebuke you. Remember that morning of creation that we read about in Job 38? It said the stars of God sang together. They tell me that stars still sing. They make some kind of audible noise. They sing together at creation. But do you know who it was that sounded the note? Do you know who the pitch pipe of heaven was? It was this Lucifer. And he's thinking, if I'm the conductor of the symphony, if I'm the one that has all of this a musical ability, that I can make the sons of God shout for joy, if I can do that, I will exalt my throne above the stars of heaven. The problem was, he was doing real good until iniquity was found in his heart. And here's basically the iniquity. He wanted the praise instead of God having the praise. He was envious of God. He was covetous and desired to have what God said he could not have. Boy, how many people desire to have what God said you don't want you to have. Then he said in one point, he said, I'll sit on the mount of the congregation. There is no dispute in my mind what he's talking about. He's not talking about an earthly mountain. He's talking about that heavenly mountain. Was it the psalmist that said, I'll lift up mine eyes to the hills from whence cometh my help? He wasn't talking about earthly hills. He was talking about that heavenly Zion that God said, I'll set my king on my holy hill, and then nothing nobody can do about it. That belongs to him who has a clean heart, a pure heart. That's the one that will ascend into the hill of the Lord. And yet Lucifer said, I will do it. But he's not qualified to do it. Just as he's not qualified to replace the Father, he's not qualified to replace the Son. The mountain is an appointed place. It is an appointed time, kind of like a church service. God will command all the angels of God to worship Him. I'm not talking about that mountain that would cause Moses to exceedingly fear and quake, but I'm talking about Mount Zion. I'm talking about the city of the living God, that heavenly Jerusalem with an innumerable company of angels, the general assembly and the church of the firstborn, the God, the judge, and the spirits of just men made perfect, and Jesus, the mediator of the new covenant. And he wants to replace that and said that he won't ever do it. He may think he will. It may look like he will. But when he's incorporated into man and sets in that temple and proclaims himself to be God and to be worshipped, no, no, it won't work. In verse 13, the location of the throne of God is in the north. Did you ever hear people say, well, which way's up? They'll say, well, now if a fellow was standing in Australia and a fellow was standing in West Virginia, you ever heard that junk? Which way's up? They're looking the opposite way and they're looking, hey, let me help you. North is up. Look at any map. Go to a dime store, get you a map. And whenever you find the top of that map, it'll always point north. Because the throne of God is located in the north. I'm talking about the place where he makes his visible presence known. There's a hole up there in the north somewhere, a door that's going to open there one of these days, and we're going to be caught out to go that way. But he said, I will ascend on the sides of the north. Wonder why he picked that direction. He may know more than you thought he did. Said, I'll be above the clouds. Now clouds are, they tell me, I think about the highest clouds are something more like 60,000 feet. I think that's probably as high as a mankind has ever known. That just above the rapture, if you will. I'm going to ascend into above the clouds. What cloud? You know there was a cloud that led the children of Israel through the wilderness. If you're into Hebrew, that their word, and I don't know how to pronounce it, I'm not into Hebrew. Shekinah. Shekinah, I don't know what it is. But there was a glory cloud that filled the temple and filled the tabernacle and led the children of Israel by day as a cloud and by night as a fire. Isn't that interesting? And he said, I'm going to go above that fire. I'm going to ascend above that cloud. I'm going to exalt my throne up there. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 1 talks about a great cloud of witnesses. I'll be above those witnesses. Everybody will look to me. Revelation chapter 14, verse 16, there's one sitting on a cloud and he thrusts in a sickle and causes the earth to be. What cloud's he talking about? I'll be above the clouds. Verse number 15, you're not going nowhere, but down. Oh, it may look like you're going up. You may really be in charge, but I'm telling you, you will be brought down to hell. That's what the Bible said. People will look at you. They'll acknowledge that your attempt to overthrow God was destined to failure before it ever started. And so is yours, my friend. Whenever you think you're better than God, smarter than God, bigger than God, you're not. You're a dependent creature. And if it wasn't for God allowing you to walk around on His footstool and breathe His air and give you the breath to curse Him with, you couldn't curse anybody. Amen. He's shut your breath off and you won't live to get out of this building. Yeah. The Lord is above all and He will be exalted above all in that day. Now, what we need to do as we look at this and we see war in heaven. And Michael fought and the Satan, his angels fought. He took a third of them. Why would a fella take and be outnumbered 2-1? Right? These two-thirds of them stayed. Why would he think that he could conquer with only one-third of them? And if furthermore, why would people think that they could do something when the greatest, smartest being that ever was outside of God can't do it? What makes you think we can do it? Yeah, amen. Now here's what we need to do. The Bible said in 1 Timothy chapter 5 and verse 24 that some men's sins are sent ahead and some men's sins come behind. I'm so glad for that time whenever I sent my sins on up yonder to Calvary and got them taken care of. Amen. I would hate to be that whenever I got there, here they'd come. When I was boy in school, we used to play a thing called pile up. I don't know whether you remember or not, but one guy'd fall down, another guy'd jump on top of him, another guy'd jump on top of him, another guy'd jump on top of him, and you're on the bottom, and just about the time you think you're ready to get up, here comes somebody, and wham! I'd rather be that guy that got out as I would that guy that let that whole thing collapse on me. I'm saying today that if we do not get our sins to the Lord Jesus Christ, we as dependent, we as finite characters, if we do not take our sins to Him before we get there, they'll come crashing down on our head. All of our wickedness, our filthiness, our sins of life will come behind us and they'll crush us. Amen. I'm glad, thank God, that I sent a whole pile in front of me. Jesus dealt with them on the cross of Calvary. And today, I have no intentions of trying to overthrow God. I just say, thank you, Lord, for letting me go to heaven. Lucifer, all these years, he thought he could make it. You not make it. People think all the time, I'll be okay. They'll tell the preacher, I'll be all right. I'm not worried about it. That's because you haven't got there yet. Whenever that great judgment day comes and you stand before God and the books are opened, you better pray you got something to balance those books. And I'll tell you the only thing that can balance your book is to take your sins and put them over here and take the blood of Jesus Christ and put it over here. And the scale will balance out. Otherwise, you're going to slide off the scale. And like Satan, you're going to slide into hell. Oh, God, help us. If we're saved, help us to work in this revival that's coming, that we can get somebody else pulled out of the fire and get them to realize that it's foolish to war against God. God is going to be the winner unless you get on the winning side. Will you bow for prayer?